This song reminds us of really the title of our sermon this morning and the subject of our sermon this morning, Why Born of a Virgin? If you do not have an outline, you will need one, especially if you are guests this morning, you'll need one. We study the Bible carefully this morning, and our church loves to do that. We want you to be able to take the notes home and be able to think about this message through the week. We believe that you will grow more and that you will get more out of it if you will do that. As we make sure everyone has an outline, and as we get started, I want you to think about something. The Bible and all that is in the Bible fits together like lock and key. Think about that. We use that phrase, like lock and key. A lock is expressly for the purpose of keeping someone out of something, keeping something hidden or concealed. But the key has to be a specific key. And the only thing that can really open that lock, designed in general fashion, is a particular key for it. And so when you say that a key has to fit a particular lock, what you're saying is there is a particular precision that is there. And so how many of you have ever gone and had a key made, and you go home, and it what? It doesn't work. It's because there's this tiny thing, part of the key. It's not the proper key. It's not quite right. And so, like lock and key is talking about precision. I want you to think about the finest Swiss watch that could ever be made. Perhaps a pocket watch, or perhaps a watch that you would wear on your wrist. And I'm not talking about the electronic ones. I'm not talking about the digital ones. I'm talking about the old-timey ones. Have you ever, and maybe it's the guys that have done this more than the gals, but have you ever seen a broken watch and then just kind of looked to see what's inside of it? Have you ever done that before? I've done that before. The watch wasn't working anymore. Granddad said it's no good. You can throw it away. Well, I had to open it up to see what was in there. And I was absolutely amazed at how intricately together it was. And in fact, it was so intricately together that it was designed to keep time. It was designed to be so precise that it would hold time. Well, in a far more, an exceedingly greater way, the Bible fits together like lock and key, or like the precision of a Swiss watch. And even far beyond. And this message this morning is going to, you're going to see some things here as we read the scripture and as we read New Testament passages, we read some Old Testament passages, and we read some of the theological passages of the New Testament, you are going to see how the Bible fits together like lock and key, and not just the Bible, but all of God's plan, because that's what the Bible is. It's the revealing of God's plan. So in a broader sense, we begin to see that God has this glorious plan that fits perfectly together. Now, there's sometimes when we come across things in Christianity, in our Christian tradition, where we have no idea what it really means or the significance of it. And I remember for a long time, even growing up in this church, I really didn't get what the virgin birth was all about. I always thought it was kind of awkward that we were talking about virgins as a kid. Did any of you ever feel that way? Kind of thought, isn't that kind of an awkward subject? I mean, why are we talking about something that has to do with sexuality and all these other things? And that, just that little phrase and just that idea would often throw me off, where I wouldn't really be able to focus and listen to the much broader context and the much broader important significance of this idea. And so this morning, I hope to blow that out of the water for you if you were plagued like me with that kind of really not understanding the significance of why God did what he did the way that he did it. And this morning, we, I believe, can come to a much greater perspective and a much greater picture. But in order to do that, we want to read the gospel narrative of the birth of Christ. Now, the Apostle Paul told Timothy, give special attention to the public reading of Scripture. And so as Christians, we believe that the Bible is important and that we should read it. Amen? We should not only read it privately, but we should read it publicly, which is part of what we've just done in a responsive reading. But this morning you see that there are two longer narratives, longer than usual for a message, but that doesn't necessarily mean the sermon is longer, but we do want to see the picture that is here, especially in view of the virgin birth. So if you would, just kind of warm up your pen, get that ready, get your notes out, let's get ready here. And I want you to see, first of all, and I have a couple of images on the screen just to help you with this. I want you to imagine Joseph asleep. Joseph asleep as they're coming up on the birth of Christ. And it's within that context that we will see this text that is here. So Joseph is asleep. Fill it in. Joseph is told in a dream that Jesus is coming to his fiancée. So look in verse 18, Matthew chapter 1 and verse 18. Now the birth of Jesus Christ took place in this way. So Matthew's telling us how it happened. When his mother Mary had been betrothed, that means promised to Joseph, before they came together, she was found to be with child from the Holy Spirit. So, underline that, before they came together, she was found to be with child from where? The Holy Spirit. Look at verse 19. And her husband Joseph, being a just man and unwilling to put her to shame, resolved to divorce her quietly. Wow. Lots of tension here. Think about it. They're engaged. This is, you know, the actual wedding has not happened yet. This picture of the time of engagement is here. They're betrothed to one another, but she is pregnant, and he is wondering, what in the world has happened? This obviously, there's only one way this happens as far as he understood, and he is going to say, I'm not going to marry this, but instead of publicly shaming her, he's going to quietly and respectfully divorce her and say, I'm not going to enter into this in this circumstance. So that's what he's quietly preparing to do. Look at verse 20. But as he considered these things, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream. So the idea is that he was perhaps asleep, has probably been on his mind just a consuming time for him. It's been on his mind, perhaps he falls to sleep in this, and here comes the dream. And so the Lord appears to him in a dream. Joseph, son of David, reminding him, you are a son of David. This is through whom the Messiah will come. Joseph, son of David, do not fear to take Mary as your wife. Look what he says. For that which is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus. For he will save his people from their sins. Verse 22, all this took place to fulfill what the Lord had spoken by the prophet. Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and they shall call his name Matthew. So that verse 23 is really from Isaiah, the prophet 700 years earlier that had prophesied that this was going to happen. And so he says, you shall call his name Emmanuel. And then Matthew comments, which means God with us. When Joseph woke from sleep, he did as the angel of the Lord commanded him. He took his wife, but knew her not. That means they did not have intercourse, but knew her not until she had given birth to a son. And he called his name Jesus. So the first picture of this is going to Joseph where we see this calling. But we also know that an angel of the Lord, Gabriel, came to Mary. So fill in Mary. Mary told by the angel Gabriel. And this is not from Matthew, but from Luke. And so Luke gives us a picture of God dealing with Mary. Look in verse 26. In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent from God to a city of Galilee named Nazareth, to a virgin betrothed to a man whose name was Joseph, of the house of David. That's very significant because the prophecies had said that the Messiah will come, the one who would save the world, will come through David's line. And so here again, we see Luke pointing out, this is just as the prophecy has declared, middle of verse 27. And the virgin's name was Mary. And he came to her and said, "Greetings, O favored one." This is the angel Gabriel came to her. "Greetings, O favored one. The Lord is with you." Verse 29, but she was greatly troubled at the saying and tried to discern what sort of greeting this might be. And the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And behold, you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus." Verse 32, and he will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. You see, not the son of Joseph, but the Son of the Most High. And the Lord God will give to him the throne of his father David. There is the line, the kingly line that God had promised. Verse 33, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end. Now that's very important. Of his kingdom there will be no end. You see, this is not an earthly kingdom. This is a heavenly kingdom. This is a spiritual kingdom. This is separating this leader king from all other leader kings, because every other king who's ever had a kingdom, his kingdom has come to an end. Look at verse 33. And Mary said to the angel, "How will this be, since I am a virgin?" Very natural question for her. Now look at verse 35. And the angel said to her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be called Holy, the Son of God. And behold, your relative Elizabeth, in her old age, has also conceived a son, and this is the sixth month with her who was called barren." So there's even another miracle that has occurred. John the Baptist's mother, Elizabeth, has conceived that is there. Look at verse 37. "For nothing will be impossible with God." I love that. Not even a virgin birth or a barren woman like Elizabeth. Verse 38. And Mary said, "Behold, I am the servant of the Lord. Let it be to me according to your word." And the angel departed from her. So this picture of the virgin birth is not, it's not a side comment that somebody could say, "Oh, that maybe isn't what the Bible really meant," or, you know, that's mentioned so briefly, we don't really know what it means. No, the virgin birth, we need to understand as Christians, the virgin birth is exceedingly clear. In fact, it's spoken of numerous times in Old Testament and in New Testament. And in the New Testament, it's given a very prominent narrative so that we understand. Why would God do that? Why is that so important? It has immense importance to our understanding of God's plan of salvation. Notice here with me, the scripture is very clear that Jesus was conceived in the womb of his mother Mary by a miraculous work of what? The Holy Spirit. Fill that in, of the Holy Spirit. And without a human father. So this is truly a very clear statement given to us by the Bible. Notice the bottom statement that is here, and this is part of many confessions, statements of faith, catechisms, creeds. And notice what it says. Jesus Christ was fully God and fully man in one person, and will be so forever. So don't turn your sheet over just yet, but just kind of notice this statement. He is fully God, he's fully man, in one person, and he's going to be this way forever. You see, after he died on the cross and rose again and continued to teach and continued to show himself to the disciples, and then later ascends into heaven, when he ascended into heaven, he did not go into a bodiless state. The Bible makes very clear throughout the rest of the New Testament that Jesus remains in bodily form in heaven. And so this part of this picture is that when we get to heaven, his wounds will still even be visible there. We will still be able to see the bodily sacrifice that was made for us that is alive. And so this is a very important concept. He's going to be this way forever, and it's all part of God's grand plan. Now, I want you to flip the sheet over. Safe to do that now. And we look at the question, why is this so significant? Why is it so significant that Jesus was born of a virgin? Why is this a big deal? And you know, I just think that Christians ought to be really informed. I believe that we ought to know what we believe, and I believe that we should know why we believe what we believe. We've lived in over the last 150 years in American culture in something that we call cultural Christianity, which just kind of assumes that everybody understands and everybody knows, you know, the basic things. And, you know, you just kind of go to church and you just kind of go through certain religious motions depending on what denomination you're a part of. And hopefully, you know, it's much of the I'm okay, you're okay, oh yeah, of course, we're Christians. And we've not really looked very carefully at the Word of God. And part of that is because American productivity has been great. Our society has been growing in wealth. We've been a world leader. Our economy is strong. Standard of living goes up. We have more and more freedoms, more and more wealth, more and more things that occupy our time, more and more systems that supposedly give us more time to do leisure things. But it's funny how, you know, microwaves didn't bring less stress. They brought more stress, I think, in a lot of ways. Cell phones certainly haven't brought less stress. I mean, even though you can talk to anybody anywhere all the time, I mean, it's just, it's interesting how we allow the things that happen to us culturally very often to take us away from some of the most basic truths. And we've met some all-time lows as far as what Christians really understand. And so that is why I want to be very careful in our church to study what God's Word says and how it systematically plays out into His glory and our salvation. And so that's part of the reason that we want to look at this, is that you should know why it's a big deal that Jesus was born of a virgin. You should know why that miracle and that statement of God is for you and for us. And these four are just, there's many other things that we could mention here, but here are four that I want you to see. Why is this so significant? Number one, the virgin birth was a prophetic sign. Fill in the word prophetic. It was a prophecy. It was a foretelling. But notice the word sign that I've already left in there. Circle the word sign. And just kind of notice the word above it that says significant. What does the word significant begin with? It's a sign. You see, this is a signal. And so the signal was prophesied by God. And part of the great beauty of this, and some of you perhaps did the devotional reading last night from John Piper. I want to encourage you, if you're not doing devotional readings out of one of the devotionals for Advent, that you get one in the bookstore and start tonight doing that. But our family read the one from last night, and John just rightly said, God makes promises, and he delivers on those promises, and he wants us to know that. All through the Old Testament, God is telling us what is going to happen. All through the Old Testament, God is laying out our salvation. He's saying, this is for you. This is what I'm going to do. And all the way through, he's giving bits of prophecy and bits of foretelling so that we can see that his word is reliable and so that we can read his word and know that it's going to come true. But also, the words that he has spoken to us in that promise sense, that God always delivers on his promise. He always is truthful. So this is a sign of his truthfulness. And so fill this in, that his child was the promised Messiah. So this child was the one that they were looking for. This child was the one that had been promised. Look at Luke from Isaiah chapter 7 and verse 14. And right out there on the left side, prophecy. Because Isaiah 7:14 is prophecy and Luke 1:35 is fulfillment. We even saw this Wednesday night for those who came to Bible study. Look what it says in Isaiah 7:14. Therefore, the Lord himself, underline that those three words, the Lord himself. Therefore, the Lord himself will give you a sign. You see, so this isn't a sign through human forms. This virgin birth thing, this is from the Holy Spirit. This is from God. The Lord himself will give you a sign. The virgin will conceive. I mean, how crazy is that? How ludicrous is that? What does that even mean? How's that even possible? It's not possible except for a miraculous event that God would orchestrate. The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and you will call him Emmanuel. And Emmanuel means what? God with us. And so that's such an appropriate name that we see in Old Testament. You know, there's it's amazing. One theologian from about 150 years ago wrote, there are 365 different references in name to Jesus Christ or to the Messiah. One for each day of the year, I guess, but roughly 365. The word Jesus is mentioned 909 times in the Bible. It's amazing. The word that is important, and we'll see why this is so important. Notice this in the fulfillment in Luke 1:35, and this is the angel speaking to Mary that we just read. And the angel said, so here's the fulfillment of the prophecy of Isaiah 7, the Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One to be born will be called Son of God. Again, this is Emmanuel. This is God with us. This is the Son of God made into human form deity. So the first big point is the virgin birth is a prophetic sign. Hey, God is truthful. God delivers on his promise. And here is the one that he is signaling. There's not another Messiah that is born of a virgin. This is the one. Number two. The virgin birth shows that salvation exclusively comes from God. The virgin birth shows that salvation exclusively comes from God. We see this in what we just read in Matthew 1:21. Notice Matthew 1:21 on the screen. She will bear a son, you will shall call his name Jesus. And then look what the screen says. For he will save his people from their sins. That's the word Jesus. This is Yahweh saves, or Jehovah saves. This is the word Joshua from the Old Testament. And so Jesus' very name shows his function. The fact that God is the one who saves. You cannot save yourself. You can't be saved by another human being. You need God to save you. Salvation only comes from God. This is part of his beautiful design of showing us the enormous nature of his grace, the greatness of his grace, that it's not you who will save yourselves as humans or even as individuals, but it is purely God. You see that I've mentioned there Ephesians 2:8 and 9. Some of you know what those verses say, but it says, by grace you have been saved through faith, that not of yourselves. It is what? A gift of God. This is from God. Now I want you to see one of the great theological books of the New Testament, Galatians 4, explains this. Notice Galatians 4, verses 4 and 5. But when the fullness of time had come, God sent forth his Son, born of woman, born under the law, to redeem those who were under the law. Circle these words. So that we might receive adoption as sons. You see, this picture is that God comes into the world, into human form, in order to save us. Now, I wrote in my own notes here underneath Galatians 4 and 5, Jesus is born into our sin to save us out of our sin. So Jesus comes down and he's born into our sin. Now, let me also remind you that God's word tells us that he who knew no sin became sin. Jesus became our sin. Jesus became all of the evil that you've ever done. Jesus, the innocent Son of God, becomes sin on the cross, taking the wrath of God, taking the judgment of God, taking the punishment of God, God dying for God's people, all for God's glory. And so we see that Jesus is born into the law. He's born in and he joins us under this law so that we might receive adoption as sons. I love 1 John 4, 9 through 10. and it's right here, also says it in a very similar way, but notice this: in this the love of God was made manifest among us. That God, circle the word God, that God sent his only son into the world, not Joseph and Mary. God sent his only son into the world so that we might live through him. That's the reason that Jesus would come, so that we can live. In verse 10, in this is love. So love is mentioned twice. The love of God was made manifest. In verse 10, in this is love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his son to be the propitiation for our sins. That means the satisfaction for our sins. You see, the picture in 1 John 4, 9 through 10 is really a Christmas picture. This is speaking of Jesus not only being born, but the reason that he was being born into the law, into humanity, under the law, and all for the sake of saving his people from their sins. And let me remind you that from the very start, Jesus was rejected. And I want us to say this over and over again, every Christmas. Think about the narrative. Joseph and Mary are showing up in Bethlehem for the census. They have to go look, they're looking for an inn because they're from Nazareth. They've traveled down to Bethlehem, and there is no what? There is no room in the inn. So even before he is actually born, there's no room for him in this world, in our hearts. And so he's relegated to the place of great humility, and God is showing us his tremendous humility. Not born in a palace in Rome or in Athens, but he's born into a humble horse's stall in Bethlehem. And so not only do we see that great no room, but we also see Herod in the very beginning saying, oh, there's a rival king. These wise men come up saying, we're here to worship the king. He goes, what king? Well, you know, the one from the scriptures. And so Herod pursues him. And so Jesus right away is being rejected even unto death by this world. And then fast forward 30 years, and Jesus begins his ministry, and in the opening days of his ministry, when he says, surely this scripture has come true today, as he's read from the book of Isaiah, one of his first times of teaching and beginning his ministry, they ran him out of the synagogue to throw him off a cliff and kill him. And so from the very beginning, we see this. That was the Jewish people in his own synagogue. And then we see the religious leaders, and then we see the Roman leaders, then we see all the world turning until the point when he is going to the cross, they all turn away and he is alone in the night before his crucifixion as he's being mocked and jeered and tortured. And so we see that we didn't love him. That's what I want you to see in verse 10 of 1 John or 1 John 4. 10. Look what it says. In this is love, not that we have loved God. You see, we didn't love God. We didn't receive Christ. But that he loved us and sent his son to be the propitiation for our sins. The third reason that we need to understand that the virgin birth is so important is this. Number three, the virgin birth brings together full deity, important word for Christians to be comfortable with, the full deity, or if you're writing that, kids, you can put above that, godness, the essence of God, the godness. This is God being like himself, the full deity and the full humanity in one person, in one person. So here's the picture that Jesus wasn't one or the other, but he was both. And that was important not only for his birth, but we see his birth is what's showing us that. Where that's really important is in his death for our sins and in his resurrection overcoming our sins. Because you see, if he was just human and born of humans, it would have been an inappropriate sacrifice, and we'll see why in just a moment. But if he was just God, we could not understand and relate to that. How would be there really be the picture of God entering into our mess, God entering into our sin, into our condition, and receiving the, or being the perfect sacrifice. You see, there's some other inferior possibilities about this. Why did God choose to come down and impregnate a righteous young woman in Israel? Why would he do that? Why wouldn't he have just said, okay, I'm going to make the bodily form of Jesus, Messiah, in heaven, and I will send him down. So here's the idea of totally in heaven. Why didn't he just form a heavenly human being in heaven and say, this is God in the flesh from heaven, not involving anyone from the human race? Why wouldn't he do that? You see, if it was totally in heaven, then it's difficult for us to recognize his humanity. It's difficult for us to recognize him being with us, him being one of us, him becoming our sin. But see, notice the next one here. What if it was just Joseph and Mary? What if it was just all done right here through a righteous young couple, and God said, I've decided to do this, I've just decided to make it Joseph and Mary in this way? You see, then it's difficult for us to recognize his godness or his deity. So in one sense, we would have trouble understanding his humanity. In the other sense, we would have trouble understanding his deity. But God, in his perfect design, chose to come and bring together his creation with himself. And in doing that, he is showing the massive relational nature that he has and how much he loves us, that he would become, listen, that he would become one of us. You know, when I was a kid, I used to play with anthills. Some of you have heard me say this before. I used to fight the ants in the backyard. And, you know, I would see the ants, and I would sit there and I would watch them. And I remember in Proverbs it said, consider the ant. And so I would go out there and I would consider the ants, and I would watch them. Did you ever, as a kid, trail ants all the way into the house, you know, and whatever, through the wall, whatever, and you see this line of ants, and you can see them, and then you dig into their colony, and you see how they're all set up, and you watch the things on PBS about the little ant pet. You know, you see this whole world of ants that is down there. So disciplined, so together and everything else. And, you know, if I ever wanted to communicate with them, I could stand up there in my backyard and yell at them or just kind of come to them. And I don't know that I could ever write something in ant language or anything along those lines that they would easily understand. But it would be very interesting. I used to imagine as a kid, what would it be like to become an ant? That'd be super cool. Be super cool, run around, see all their paths, how do they see under there, you know, and you go up, steal food out of the kitchen, take it back, you know, and it, I mean, just become an ant, become one of them. In a far greater way, that is what God did with us. God perfectly became, he remains himself, but yet he becomes one of us for a purpose. And so notice this, the combination of God's deity and his humanity allows us to see his dual nature. And this becomes very important when we think about the rigors and the troubles of our life. We think about our sin struggle. We think about all of the things that are here. But yet we have a Savior who was one of us. We have a Savior who wasn't just the booming voice that created the universe, but he was the person of Christ who would come and walk among us and live among us. That is very instructive to me when I'm in trouble. That is very helpful to me when I experience pain. That is very helpful to me when I have loved ones who are really grieving and really hurting, to know that God was or is one of us. He's become one of us, not in a profane way, but in a eminently holy way. You see, here's part of one of the themes that you can see from number three. An important theme is this, that we see the Creator, we see this idea. The Creator works through the creation. He is involved with his creation. In fact, he comes himself and he works through the creation for his purposes and for his glory. He doesn't remain a distant and afar from us. He comes and he joins us. And what's amazing is it's not only Christ doing this for the salvation of Christians, but think about this. It's Christians doing this for the salvation of the nations. That God even comes and he works through us to be his voice to South Florida. He works through you to be his voice to your family members, to your friends, to your coworkers, to your neighbors. That God has chosen to work through his creation. He works with us. He's with us in this. And it's not just the Dale Roton and Elaine Roton who are missionaries that are afar, and Andrew and Marcy who went to Africa. Oh, well, God works through missionaries. No, God works through all Christians. That is his design. And so we see that he comes and he works through the physical life of Jesus as a full human being. And yet God, and so he gives us his spirit as followers saved by Jesus to also be used. So I want you to see that the virgin, number three, is showing us that the virgin birth reveals to us that God is at work not only through bringing salvation through the body of Christ to us, but he even continues that through us as his followers. He gives us his spirit. He says, without me, you can do nothing, but with me, you can do everything. You will be my witnesses in Judea, Jerusalem and Judea and Samaria and to the uttermost parts of the earth. This is a huge concept that we see God valuing who we are and what we do in bringing us to salvation in Christ through working in the creation, through the bodily creation that he has made. And so, look at with me, why is this so important? Number four, the virgin birth makes possible Christ's, and this is incredibly important, Christ's sinless, perfect sacrifice on the cross. The virgin birth makes possible Christ's sinless, perfect sacrifice on the cross. Now, there's the concept in the Bible of the first Adam and the second Adam. The first Adam being the human father of the human race, Adam and Eve and their sin. They immediately, Genesis 1 and 2, they're created. Genesis 3, they fall. The rest of the Bible, Genesis 4 and on, all the way to the end, is about God restoring the world and redeeming the world and restoring it to the way that it was before the fall. This is the grand narrative of the Bible. But we see this, that when Adam and Eve sinned, we went with them. We are born into this world sinful. Anyone that is part of this world knows, and any parent in this room, I great illustrative point here, do you ever have to teach your children to do the wrong thing? They come naturally wired to do the wrong thing. But you have to work very hard for 15, 20, 25, some of you, 50 years. You have to work very hard to help your children know to do the right thing, right? And it's because we have something called the sin nature. We have an inherited sin nature within us. No one ever has to teach their children to do the wrong thing. The hope is to teach them to do the right thing. We see this in Psalm 51, 4 and 5. Notice Psalm 51. Against you and you only I have sinned, David would say, and done what is evil in your sight, so that you may be justified in your words and blameless in your judgment. Look at verse 5. In fact, read verse 5 out loud together with me, starting with behold. Verse 5, behold, I was brought forth in iniquity, and in sin did my mother conceive me. Now, that's not the idea that, you know, that David's mother was a woman that was out of wedlock or something like that. No, the picture is, this is the inherited sin condition of all humanity. We also see it in Romans chapter 5 and verse 12. Look at the screen. Look what it says. Therefore, just as sin came into the world through one man and death through sin, and so death spread to all men because all sinned. Romans 5 is theologically laying the base for us to see that we share in Adam's sin, and our own sin nature, our own hearts prove that to us every day. Look at the next passage, Romans chapter 5, verses 18 through 19. So a little bit further on, it says, therefore, as one trespass led to condemnation of all men, So one act of righteousness leads to justification and life for all men. So here's Adam and here's Jesus. Adam's sin condemns us. Jesus' work saves us. Look at verse 19. For as by the one man's disobedience the many were made sinners, so by the one man's obedience the many will be made righteous. Who is this one man's obedience? Jesus. You see, this is his humanity in his deity coming together in him bringing us, breaking this inherited sin. So fill that in. These passages reveal to us and the inherited sin problem. Now, there's a lot of people that don't understand that they have an inherited sin problem. In fact, if you talk to people out in our community and you ask them if they're going to go to heaven and they say, and you say, why are you going to go to heaven? Very often they'll say to you, oh, because I'm basically a what? A good person. And they don't realize, they're not thinking carefully. They're comparing themselves to others very often. Now, there's some people in our community that will say, I don't know why you say I'm going to heaven. I'm not going to heaven. I'm going straight to hell and I know it. I mean, occasionally, when you're talking to someone in our community, there's some people that will just very honestly and openly say that because they look into their heart. They know their heart. They can't get away from their heart. And they know that they're far from God. That's not normal. Normally, we have a higher view of ourselves, and this is called pride, which so condemns us ultimately. But very often we have a higher view of ourselves than we should, and we think of ourselves in comparison to others. And so we say, well, I'm not down at the Broward County Jail, or I'm not down at the detention center, the federal prison in Miami. You know, I'm here, I'm doing pretty good. God, you know, he's going to weigh me out here and it's going to be okay. And there's numerous places in Scripture where you go, that is simply not true. The Bible makes clear to us, for all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Isaiah says, for your sins have cut you off from God, and he will not hear your prayers. So we see that in our flesh, we have an inherited sin problem. And that's all of us. So there's no one that's going to be the right sacrifice. I mean, as much as I appreciate David, these two Davids sitting right here, and these guys are godly men. Callie, David's wife, godly folks that I love and appreciate, as good as they are, they can't die for you because they're not perfect. And you can't die for them because you're not perfect. There's only one who can come and forgive the millions of Andrew Coleman's sins. You see, fill this in, no mere human sacrifice would be sufficient for God's standard. Why? Because his standard is perfect. And he only judges us according to himself. You see, the sacrifice for our sins had to be, fill it in, completely perfect. Because God is completely perfect, and in him there is no sin. And he accepts no sin. He is without blemish. And the sacrifice for our sins would have to be without blemish. Underneath the term there, without blemish, just right in there, Old Testament law. You will see in the Old Testament law over and over and over again when they are taking a sacrifice that is a picture of the coming Messiah, when they are to take a sacrifice, a lamb or a goat or something, it is to not be one that's blemished. It's to be one that you look it over and you go, this one is good, and this is as good as we can get. But you see, every sacrifice isn't that which would pay for their sins. It was only pointing to the sacrifice of Christ. You see, Old Testament believers were saved by the same blood of Jesus that New Testament believers are saved by. A lot of Christians that don't understand that, they say, well, you know, Old Testament people, they're saved through their sacrifices. Absolutely not. Their sacrifices were all pointing to the coming Messiah. Just like every single time we observe the Lord's Supper in this place, when the body of believers is met, we are saying, we are pointing back to what Jesus did on the cross for our sins. We remember that a sacrifice was made. So Old Testament was looking forward to the coming of the Messiah. New Testament believers are looking back to the fact that he came. And here we see that he can only be the one who would save us from our sins. Look at 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 18 and 19. Knowing that you were ransomed from the futile ways inherited from your forefathers. And just right above feudal ways, your sin. So this is all your sin. This is all your foolishness. This is all of our ungodliness. Look at verse 18. Knowing that you were ransomed from the futile ways inherited from your forefathers, not with perishable things such as silver or gold, but you were ransomed with the precious blood of Christ. Like that, circle the word like that of a lamb without blemish or spot. You see, it doesn't say exactly the lamb of the lamb without blemish or spot. It's saying like a lamb. And so the picture is that this one was perfect and holy. The precious blood of Jesus would be that which died for your sins. So in the passage that we began this whole sermon with, from Luke chapter 1, we see this verse again. And hopefully it means more than it's ever meant to you before in light of these four things. But look with me in Luke chapter 1, verse 35 at the bottom. And the angel said to her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be called Holy, the Son of God." What did we do with that Holy Son of God? We nailed him to a cross. We rejected him utterly. And in his love, he was showing us that even in our rejection, his love continues. And so he calls us to recognize that he is the only hope. It is my great hope and my prayer that after you have heard this today, that you can know that a Savior has died for your sins. A Savior has died for your sins if you believe upon him. You see, he has died and he has paid for the sins of his children, and his children come to him in belief. If you've never come to him, if you've never turned to him in belief, if you've never turned to him away from your sin and come to him in faith in Jesus, as you hear and sense his Spirit calling you, my friend, today I call you to do that. You can come to Christ. This birth of this Christ child can be for you. His death can be for you. His resurrection can overcome all of your problems of sin, bondage, and the vices that he holds on you. He can set you free from the sin of this world and the sins of your own heart. You see, it's good that Christians understand the beautiful sign that God gave to us in the virgin birth. It says that this one, this Jesus, is the one who can come and pay for the sins of the world. So here's the key question for you. Here's the key question. So how does the reality that Christ was humanly able, two key words, to be your substitute, because he was a human, and divinely able to be your sacrifice because he was perfect God, cause you to think and feel about Christmas? I hope and pray that the profound nature of Christ's birth grips your heart this Christmas. And listen, that the profound nature that God's love would enter into the world in a holy way and become our sin so that we might become the righteousness of God. I pray that that will turn our hearts to live lives that are righteous lives, glorifying to God. That we don't want to live Christian lives because we want to be saved. We want to live Christian lives because we are saved. This is the glorious nature of the virgin birth and the glorious nature of God's great and intricate plan of salvation. Would you pray with me?